African father in America. Tujikaze, tujikaze, jikaze. Tujikaze, tujikaze, jikaze. African father in America. Tujikaze, tujikaze, jikaze.
You are listening to African Father in America podcast by Simon Javan Okelo, live from Seattle, Washington, USA.
Greetings, everybody. My name is Simon Javan Okelo, and you're listening to the African Father in America podcast. I'm excited to be here with you today, especially because we have a really special guest. Her name is Havoc Music, all the way from Nairobi, Kenya. And Havoc, originally born as Tracy Awino, is a multiple award-winning Kenyan gospel dancehall artist signed at Crucial Sounds record label under producer John Taze. Havoc is a born-again Christian who has great passion to lead many to the Christendom through her music. Havoc has been nominated for several awards. In 2018, she won the Artist of the Year at the DEAR Awards in Dallas, Texas. She also won the Artist of the Year at the 2018 Nairobi Awards, and she won the Reggae Raga Song of the Year at the 2017 Maranatha Awards in Kenya. Havoc has also ministered on several platforms across the world. She has shared the gospel on many international platforms, including Paturankings album launch in 2019, as well as Jakiwa's concert in Nairobi. So it's an honor and privilege to be here with my amazing, amazing sister, Havoc Music. How are you today?
I'm fine. How
nice.
Are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you for, joining me for an episode of the African Father in America. Since we connected through Instagram, I just wanted to first let you know that it's through Echo, Echo Dida. Wow. the other amazing Kenyan gospel artist that I learned about you is a great friend of mine and someone that I also look up to. And the way he speaks of you just made me feel like reaching out to you in order for you to be one of the initial female artists I interview for this. So please share with us your story, your upbringing, and just looking at your pictures and your videos, you're a happy person, and even now you're just filled with smiles and happiness. Share with us where all of that comes from.
Thank you so much for having me today.
Of course.
And it's such an honor to be here, and wow, Ekodida is such a good friend to me. He supports me in everywhere I want, everywhere I need, because he has been very supportive to my music journey, and I'm so happy that he connected me with you.
Of course.
Yeah. So about my story, my name is Tracy Awino, like you said. My stage name is Havoc Music. Havoc is an abbreviation. It's an abbreviation. Each letter has its own meaning. So Havoc is highly anointed gospel of Christ. Yeah, and I'm a born-again Christian. I love God as my personal savior. And I do gospel music. Major in dancehall music. And I started music when I was young. I started singing when I was young in church. But professionally, I started recording in the year 2016 after I finished school in the So I'm born in a family of six children, raised by a single mother my entire life.
Right.
So my life has been quite okay. My upbringing has been quite okay. I was raised in Kangemi area. So life was not easy there. Finding food, finding rent to pay the house.
Right.
Yeah, was very hard for me.
Right.
Those mom could not afford to provide to us all or for us all.
Right. So
sometimes we could find ourselves hustling for our own money for clothes.
Right. You know? Right.
Yeah. For food.
Right. It was
for my upbringing, and also getting to grow without a father figure in my childhood was very challenging, because I believe if my father was there, there's some things that I could have gotten without struggling, you know.
Right, right.
Yeah. So wasn't there from since I was born.
Mm.
So life was very hard for us in Kangemi.
Right.
No clothes. We had to hustle. Mom was just having a small saloon, which was helping her get money.
Right.
Eat.
Yeah.
Around 2017, her saloon got burnt down. So,
oh man,
got burnt down into ashes. So we had to scratch, because we don't have any place to get the money to upkeep us.
Mm.
But also through growing there and just seeing everything that is happening around, growing in a family of violence, because when I was growing up still, in a small period of my life, I grew with a stepfather.
Right.
And this father was supposed to be like a father figure to me.
Mm.
But again, chaos started, violence, violence is very huge, yani. Our home was not at peace most of the times, you know.
Right, right.
That showed you violence and lacking food, lacking money to upkeep me was quite hard for me.
Yeah.
I
can imagine, man. I can imagine. You know, my mother also had a stall in Kisumu in Manyata. You know, Manyata is the largest slum in Kisumu, and my mom sold sukuma wiki, mchele, dengu, you know, maharagwe on the street, you know. And sometime when the people that used to collect tax from business women along the street from the city council, you know, they come and they threw everything away, and it used to drive me so crazy, you know. And also, you know, just thinking about your sharing with me your story reminded me of my own situation. I was born in a polygamist marriage myself, so my dad had two wives, but my mom was the second wife, and so, you know, she was like the maid in the family. So you know, she left our rural home and came and settled in Kisumu in Manyata because, you know, she could not take it anymore. So we rarely saw our dad, you know, and I'm not that close with him, but, you know, we have a relationship. You know, so I really appreciate you, you know, being open with me about that. I wanted to go back a little bit and just talk to you about Kangemi. You know, a lot of the people who are watching or listening to the African Father in America podcast have never been to Kenya before. So I wanted you to paint a picture for somebody who, let's say you've gone to Jomo Kenyatta International Airport to pick a friend of mine up that is coming to visit you after listening to this African Father in America podcast. You know, just paint for me a picture of, you know, how things look like at the airport and where you take them before you get to Kangemi.
Okay, so basically you're asking me to describe how Kangemi looks like, or what looks like, or
and you're showing somebody who has never been before. You've just picked them from the airport, and it's not you, the artist, it's you, the little girl who was hustling to get food for clothes, but you have a pen pal, you have a friend who has showed up from the US, and you're excited to show them about your neighbor, to show them your neighborhood. And then I'm also going to be interested just to learn a bit about where would you show somebody now that you're an artist? What would you want them to see?
Wow. Okay. That is quite a tricky question, but you know, God connects people with a reason.
Yeah.
Good to be authentic in this life. You know, it's good right. to be authentic, and it's not good to live a lie.
Yeah.
If Kangemi is where you live, you better just show someone this is where I live. And yeah. you never know, maybe send that person to come and help you, you know.
Yeah.
So mine, who is coming from the US, from taking him or her to the airport, I'll get a vehicle which will take us to Kangemi. But before mm-hmm. we get to Kangemi, I'll be showing him before we reach there, we have some shopping centers, some markets, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll pass along the road, I'll be showing him or her the market and telling him this is Kangemi Market, mm-hmm. this is the center, this is mm-hmm. Westland, mm-hmm. before you get Kangemi now. But from
Kangemi, Kangemi is on the way to Kisumu, Busia, it's on Limuru Road, Waiyaki Way, right?
Yeah, it's on Waiyaki Way.
Okay, perfect. Keep
but
going.
It doesn't take long for us to get there to Kangemi.
Yeah.
So we shall be passing through shopping centers, through the Kangemi market itself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So when we get to Kangemi, there's a place called Gishagi.
Mm-hmm.
That is where we used to stay.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I'll take him to a very humble home at Gishagi.
Yeah.
or her.
Yeah.
And invite him or her into the house and just show the person around, this is my neighborhood, this is how I stay, because Gishagi is a small ghetto.
Mm.
It's a small, yeah. Mm. A community that lives together.
Mm.
Yeah. And I'll be very comfortable to show the person where I stay and how I live my life, because
right.
I know everything has a reason.
Right.
Even for that, come and see me.
Yeah.
It has Yeah.
Right. Wow. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you very much. So I just wanted you know, a lot of people hear about an artist and, you know, they don't see how much work it takes to become an artist. They don't know how much vulnerability it takes to become an artist. You know, you have to put yourself out there, in a very vulnerable way. You don't know how people are going to receive you, but you still want to speak from your heart, and you still want to present your work. You want to express yourself. It's you being a born again Christian, it's almost like you've been possessed by some spirits, and these spirits are taking you to producing music, you know. And so, why are you an artist?
Okay, I have a gift, you know?
Yeah.
Gift, and this is a God-given gift. It's a calling, by the way.
Yeah.
Because if you see me, if you look at me, I'm a person who has been raised from the ghetto.
Right.
And called for a certain crowd in the ghetto. For those, you know, those people who are just left there, they have no one to look after them. They have no one to talk to, encourage them.
Mm.
There's a better day coming ahead, you know. Those are the people called for, you know.
Mm.
My is of such people who are just need someone to talk to, someone to encourage them, you know.
Mm.
Why I'm a musician, why I am an artist is because I believe I was called for a certain people to you know, and to give them a future and a hope that God has a good plan for every one of us, even if regardless of where you're coming from.
Right.
regardless of who you are or what you've done, God has a good purpose. And that is the reason why I'm actually an artist, because first, it is a calling. I am passionate about doing music, very passionate about it.
Right.
The single day I can wake up from bed and not think of how I can improve myself as an artist and how I can write new music. Every day I have to think of ideas of how I can improve the craft, you know. And that is, that shows that artist music is in me, you know. That is born in me. It's a gift, it's a calling, it's something I'm passionate about, and that is why I started music.
Thank you. You know, when I was reading your bio, I just learned that, you know, you've performed and opened, you know, for big artists. You've performed at very, you know, amazing stages. And I just wanted you to paint the picture for me. You know, I've worked with a lot of artists too. And, you know, I've worked with people like Rocky Dauni. He's a Grammy nominated artist. I've worked with people like Uhura Runga. He's won the Grammy. He used to be the trumpeter for Macklemore and Ryan Lewis, who have won the Grammy. I'm also a board member of the Grammy Academy, by the way. So I vote for artists that, you know, eventually win or lose, you know. So, you know, whenever I organize an event, you know, the audience is in front of you and you're backstage, you've been given the mic and, you know, you're probably closing your eyes and breathing in deeply and you know, saying something to yourself.
Yeah.
I just wanted you to take me to that moment and, you know, this event that you feel like was your, you know, your most memorable performance, not the biggest platform, but the moment that, you know, you felt that this is the reason why I'm alive.
Wow. Actually, when I remember that day, I was called to perform at Paturan King's album. It was actually his album launch. He was launching it in Kenya. It was just, I had just met my management 1 week ago.
So Paturan King is from Nigeria, right?
Yeah, he's from Nigeria.
Okay. Can you describe Paturan King quickly before you go to this story, just so that the audience can understand who we are talking about, just, you know, for a few seconds?
Paturan King is also a dancehall artist in Nigeria. And what can I say about him? He's humble. He's dark in color, he's a black man, and he's very handsome. He's very talented. I don't know what to say about him, because
you've said it. So let's keep going. Let's keep going on with, you know, a week after you teamed up with your management.
My new management. So that week after that week, I was scheduled to go for the Groove Awards. Groove Awards was happening in Kenya, and I was one of them, so I was expecting to win, obviously. When I went for the main event to announce the winners, I was there seated with my mom, expecting. So when my category got there, my category reached, they announced the winner. Unfortunately, I was not the winner. So, my mom was there consulting me.
Yeah, man, that must have felt so hard, you know?
Yeah. So, she was telling me, don't worry, there's a reason for everything. So, as I was sitting, I got a call from my manager that I'm needed at Kiza. Kiza. Paturan King was launching his album. So I just told my mom that I will drop her at home and then I go for her, because I did not know what was happening at Kiza. I just, because I was called.
Right. So
when I got there, I saw I met a press conference there. Mm. People were looking for battle ranking. Mm. Everywhere there was a banner. From everything, you know.
Mm.
People from different countries were there to just take the whole event and just record it. The press people, red carpet things there.
Mm.
I just entered and went to my manager, and then he told, "I need you to sit here and watch how an album is launched, so that when yours gets here, you know what you're supposed to do."
Right.
So I was seated there. I saw many big artists from Kenya entering the room, like Kinski, BF Sauti Sol, Kagwe, Nightboy, name them, many artists from Kenya were in the room. And I was the only gospel artist in the room. So I was nervous. Okay, why am I the only gospel artist here and others are secular artists? You know, I was feeling kind of, because it was actually a club, some sort of.
Mm-hmm.
So when Pato Ranking came in, he talked and launched his, performed his songs from the album of songs.
Mm.
And to my surprise, my manager was the one hosting him, asking the album and all. So after he answered the question, I was surprised to be called on stage. He just called me on stage and told Pato Ranking, "I want you to listen to this girl. She has very good dancehall music. I just want you to listen to her." So when I was called there, everyone was clapping for me and looking at me, expecting something from me. They never knew how I sing. Even the artists from Kenya, the seculars. On stepping the stage, I was very nervous because everyone was silent, everyone was looking at me.
Wow, the anticipation, yeah. Do you feel butterflies in your belly?
yeah, because in this room they were filled with many things that you can ever mention in your life. And here there's a song from Nigeria just waiting to see me perform. So I just asked the DJ to put me my favorite song, one of my favorite songs. As I was performing there, to my surprise, Pato Ranking joined me on stage. He started singing with me.
Wow.
So people were taking the pictures, the press. And the next thing I know, the following day, I was just trending everywhere. People were talking about it. The video going around.
Wow. It's show, you know.
Yeah, it was such an awesome moment for me.
Yeah,
and the fact that there were other artists in the room, but I was the one told to perform, it also tells me that I'm doing something good. Yani, I'm doing a nice work with my ministry.
But it's also the same day that you got disappointed at Groove Awards, you know?
Yeah. So but I also thank God for the opportunity at Groove Awards, because it's also a award in Kenya. It's the biggest gospel award. Even for just getting the nomination was a big opportunity for me, which I don't give.
So that was really a big day for you, because you know you got the publicity and you are in the room, you know, with who is who in the gospel industry. Then while they were still there, you know, still you know, recovering from the aftermath of Groove Awards, you went to something else and had an impact. So that's really wonderful. You know, earlier in the initial stages of our conversation, you shared with me about, you know, your father and the fact that he was not really present in your life. And part of what I love to discuss with the, you know, listeners and guests of the African Father in America podcast is what a father figure means to them, you know. So now I just wanted you to share with me, you know, what a father figure means to you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. a father figure, let me just say, if my father was here,
yeah,
some things I would not have gone through while I was young, because I've gone through so many things that I cannot even explain to you here openly right now, because
I've gone
so many hard times.
Mm.
Even my childhood was misused, let me use that word, because I never enjoyed my childhood.
Yeah.
So a father figure is someone very important. That is what I can tell the listeners, because the father figure plays an important role in your life that even the mother cannot do, because mom can do this and that, of which I know she can do so well, but there comes a time you need a father to talk about things that you need to talk about with him. You need sometimes a father's just affection and love. A father's time in someone's life, you know, father's important role, you know. Regardless how many fathers have left their children, how fathers don't even care about their children or even where they are, play an important role in our lives, because mine, I never got to see him. I don't even know how he looks like. But I just feel like if he was here and if he would just have a good relationship with mom, I would not have gone through what I went through while I was young. The struggles I used to go through before I even started music officially, I would not go through them, because I knew he would have been there and he would have sorted this and that out. You know? So a father figure is very important in someone's life, and I would just want to urge any father out there who doesn't know where their kids are or even doesn't care about them, need their father, you know.
Yeah,
I need my dad sometimes, and I find myself going to talk to my manager about things that I should have talked about with my father, you know, not tell my mother, you know, that I feel comfortable for him to know. I reach out to my pastor. At times I reach out to good friends, you know.
So those are the father figures in your life, especially because you don't have your biological dad in your life.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Such people are the ones I just go to open up to and just talk to most of the times.
Well, if you want to talk to another father figure, just know that I'm there now.
Exactly.
Yeah. I have three girls, you know. My oldest is 6 years old. The second born is 3 years old. And the third born is 1 year old. And I used to work for a logistics company, you know, until last year. So from May last year until now, I've been with my girls every day, you know. So I'm like a full-time dad. So right now it's almost midnight, 15 minutes to midnight here in Seattle. So while it's nighttime is when I can do my own work. I can, you know, run One Vibe Africa. In fact, right before our call, I was on another Zoom call with my team in Kenya. I have a team of about 20 people that work full-time for One Vibe in Kisumu.
Wow.
Yeah, and in fact, you know, I was telling you about the virtual Madaraka Festival, and the reason we did it was to raise money for women who have been impacted by the coronavirus in Mathare, Manyata, and Slum. So we were able to raise money for 106 women, you know?
Wow.
Yeah, that's so nice. So, you know, I wanted to talk to you a little bit more about Black fathers. You know, a lot of the time, the perception out there is that, you know, Black fathers are irresponsible, Black fathers are absent. And one of the things I'm passionate about is to change this narrative so that, you know, when people think about Black fathers, they know that these people are not what we've always thought they are. They are not the lazy, absent people. and irresponsible fathers that we've always thought. So part of why I'm doing this podcast is to share new stories about, you know, Black fathers. And, you know, of course, I understand that you never had an opportunity to be with your dad physically, but there are these father figures that you've interacted with that have probably changed your perspective about Black fathers. Can you just share with us a story related to that?
Yeah, I can share. I actually don't know why people feel like Black fathers are not up to task or are not fit to raise kids, or they are just, like you said, deadbeats. We also have a program here in Kenya, a radio program that really looks at hitting on the deadbeat dad.
What's the name of that program?
It's a radio station called Radio Jambo.
Radio Jambo, yeah.
Yeah, which sometimes I feel like it's kind of making people develop so much hatred so much negativity in regards to fathers, because mostly the stories are hitting on men. They don't understand mainly what made that man leave the woman, or get understanding so that they don't understand well with the wife so that they can raise the child.
Right.
You know, the bottom line of them separating, you know.
Right.
And that they just want the father to take care of the children before them knowing what actually came about, because for them not to be together.
What
I can say is Black fathers should not be taken as people who cannot stand up for their families and their children. I know every father out there loves their children, and they feel also bad when they are not with their children. So many fathers also come up on radio and say, my wife has refused me to see my child, you know, doesn't want me to see my baby, you know, and maybe even there was no even any other issue, you know, it's just like misunderstanding, and the marriage got ruined. But if the father wants to see the child, the woman doesn't want that. So many fathers, they really want to spend time with their children, you know, but you cannot get that chance. What I can say is Black fathers are people who can stand for themselves, because also, if I can talk about my dad, I don't know, actually, I know a small story about how they got separated with mom. I also feel like he also had a part to play. He had a responsibility to make, to do, not to, you know. What I can say is, I just urge fathers out there, if you're a Black father, just look out for your family, because they have their good sides and they have their bad sides. Like my dad and my mom on very petty grounds, you know, very petty grounds, which
he never fought. What you're saying is so important, man. You know, my wife is white, and my wife and I met in Liberia. I used to work in 6 other countries in Africa before I came here. And you know, just marrying a mzungu is so different from your culture. And you know, we've been married for almost 11 years. In August, it will be 11 years. And we've had sometimes struggles. We've had to fight sometime. Sometime I'm going to live by myself. Then I think about the things we've been through, and I think about her heart. You know, she's a good human being, you know. And then I have times when I'm the one who screws up, and then she has to think about, oh, this is a good guy, let me not rush out of this relationship. And then we had kids, and you know, we have amazing kids that really encourage us to stay together because of how great they are, you know. And so you're right that you should not demonize, you know, one father because of a few other fathers that you've had that are not responsible, right?
Yeah, exactly. That is the point I was trying to say, because most of the times the men are the ones who are hitting hard, because maybe it's the woman who did something wrong, so that's why they are not together. But people don't want them to do anything concerning that. They just want to the man to take care of the child, even your children. You know, want to hear the bottom line of the story. I just want people to just know that they are, that's how they are, who care about their children. Just like you spend time with your children, they know that they have their father around, they can talk to their dad, and they stand for them. And that is what most of dads out there should look, that they should look from you, they should take it from you that you are also a good father, because spending time with your children is the most important thing you could ever do.
Yeah, it's hard. It's so hard, and you know, it just teaches me how difficult it is for mothers who are single mothers, you know.
True.
Now, you know, whenever you watch the news about the, for example, the recent killing of George Floyd, you know, the killing of Ahmaud Arbery, who was running, you know, on a Sunday afternoon in Atlanta, Georgia, you know, the killing of Breonna Taylor, you know, you know, it just shows you that white supremacy is so eminent right now. And the lives of black people is not valued, you know.
True.
So while we're living in a time like this, how do you think black fathers and black people can support each other in general?
Well, that is so good. That's a good question. And what I can just say there is the kind of support that George Floyd was given after his death. What should be emulated in this world, you know, it should be a less one out there.
Because
actually, that kind of support, even we could see even the white people on the roads protesting. Even the whites on social media, even on the television, they were protesting on the roads and fighting with the policemen because of this black person, you know. And before God, we are all equal. It doesn't matter which color you are, or where you come from, or the race you are, or the country you come from. Before God, we are all the same people, you know, and that's what people know. God doesn't favor the white person and leaves the black person. If he blesses us, he blesses us all equally. So the kind of love that George Floyd was given after his death, I would just love that people have to have learned the lesson through his death, because it shows that even the white people now support the black people. And even the white people now have learned a lesson that they should love each other regardless of who you are, you know. And that is the most important thing, because his death was a very cruel death. And it's something that a normal human being should not have done, honestly. Such a painful death for that man. And the kind of support that was shown after his death is what people should be doing. People should love each other, because love is always the answer. Love is the greatest thing that was given to us by God. So if we love each other, we shall not care about the color of anyone or where the person is coming from, because God created all. Created us in his own image. So love is the answer. People should just love.
Love is the answer. Yeah, that's a good way to get us to, you know, the end of our conversation. And I just wanted you to share with all the listeners and viewers of the African Father in America how they can connect with you after today's conversation, where they can find you online. Yeah.
So everyone who is listening to me today, I just love you to connect with me on Instagram, on Facebook, on Twitter. I am Havoc Music everywhere, on every platform. On YouTube, I'm Havoc Music. On Instagram, I'm Havoc Music. On Facebook, everywhere, just Havoc Music. And I also have a new song out. People can go and check it out. It's called Daddy. People can check it out and just comment and share. And I just love to interact with people from there.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So if you're listening to the African Father in America, Havoc Music is at Havoc Music. Yeah. That's one word, right?
Yeah.
It's one word, right? Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. Anything else that I did not ask you that you just want to share before we wind up for today?
Yeah. There's something I'd like to share with people out there.
Yeah.
That I started a foundation called Champion Girls Power Drive. It's a foundation that looks at helping girls from vulnerable communities to get sanitary towels during the pandemic and also after the pandemic. We realize that many girls are having a problem with getting the sanitary towels because there is nowhere they can get money right now to even purchase them, you know. And when a girl is on her menses, it's the hardest time of her life.
Right.
Many girls develop different moods, you know.
Right. I know it very well.
If it gets to that time and that girl doesn't have money to purchase the pads, it's very hard for
them. It's hard. You know? Yeah.
So I came up with the foundation and it's really doing well. And people can reach out and support me on my Instagram page. I have posted the poster and the paybill number. People can contribute and just help me help the other girls also.
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. And I just want to encourage you to... you know, to continue doing the amazing work that you're doing, you know, artistically and also with your foundation that you're using to help girls who are, you know, vulnerable so that they can access sanitary pads. I just want to thank you so much for making the time to join me today, Havoc. It meant a lot. To everybody who is listening to today's episode of the African Father in America, I was really privileged to have a conversation with my sister, Havoc Music from Nairobi, Kenya. And she shared with us her story. She shared with us why she's an artist. She shared with us what a father figure means to her. And she also shared with us, you know, how we can change the narrative about Black fathers, and finally how Black fathers and Black people in general can support themselves right now when white supremacy is so eminent globally. And she ended by asking you to follow her on Instagram and you know, at Havoc Music, and also support the work she's doing, which she has posted on her Instagram page. So with that, I just want to thank you so much for tuning into the African Father in America podcast with Simon Javan Okelo. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. It's
of
been
course.
A and I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
Of course. Thank you.
Father in America. Tujikaze. Tujikaze. African Father in